Hi fans, please like our video and subscribe to the RotoWire channel. Then please go to rotowire.com/pod for a free 10-day trial.
Well, folks, we begin our sixth season with me hosting this pod, and it's AJ's fifth as my co-host. It'll be a very different regular season from any that either of us has worked together on in the past. Our longtime listeners will notice one obvious change to our broadcast, as we will now have a video to go along with our audio recording, so we got to look our best as well as sound our best, partner. You'll find that on YouTube this season. You can still find us in the usual audio format if you want to listen as you did in the past, if you want to do so while driving or running, etc. We'll tweet out all the links each week so you don't miss out in any format. AJ, please tell our listeners about this YouTube platform that we'll be using and where to find it.
Yeah, so RotoWire as a whole is moving towards having some more of these podcasts available in video format. We understand that a lot of people, that's how they consume things now. So we're doing a lot more video stuff. Definitely check out the RotoWire YouTube channel. That's where you'll find things like our NBA podcasts, our NFL podcasts. Everything's going to be there. There'll be some shorter form stuff. Obviously, Paul and I like to ramble here, so we end up a little bit long, but there will be some short form stuff for a variety of sports content, and all that's available on the RotoWire YouTube channel.
Well, it looks like we're headed for a shorter season than usual, so it's going to feature likely an all-Canadian division, which I'm very excited about. It's going to be incredible ratings on TV in this country, AJ. The country stops on Saturday night when Toronto-Montreal match up, for instance, but there's going to be really intriguing matchups all the way across the board in this division. I'm really excited to see it go forward, but I'm kind of curious to see how the 24 U.S.-based teams shake down. I'm sure it's going to have a regional feel to it, but there's a couple of teams that are going to be shifted maybe outside their time zones a little bit. I'm thinking about Dallas, maybe St. Louis, not playing too many games in their time zones as they're used to. So what do you got to say about all of this from where you sit?
Yeah, I mean, I'm also excited, being down here in the States, anytime you get the Canadian teams matched up. So I'm actually really excited for that as well. I think it's going to create some great matchups. The thing I really like about the Canadian division, and Paul, you'll probably disagree with me a little bit here, but I think it's wide open. I think there's a number of teams that could win a Canadian division or finish in the top three or top four, depending on what the playoff format is. Obviously, Paul, you think the Leafs are a lock to win, but that may not be the case for the rest of it. And as far as the U.S. divisions go, yeah, I think the biggest one is it does sound like St. Louis is going to be in like a Pacific, I don't know what they're going to call them, but relatively a Pacific division loop there. Although the one thing with California's current restrictions, like San Jose really can't play in their arena right now. I don't know how far that'll progress. That's what has the 49ers playing currently in Arizona. Same kind of restrictions there. So it's possible that a team like San Jose is actually playing further to the east, and maybe that cuts down on some travel time. The other big one, obviously close to home for me, is that there was talk at one point that Pittsburgh and Washington would be in one division and the Flyers would be in another, and that just doesn't make sense. Let's be honest. Now, the Flyers have gotten better and better over the last couple of years. I don't really want to play them, 9-10 times in a season anymore. But those are just great matchups, great TV rating. So I do think they have to keep some of those groups together.
So you didn't wait very long to get your first shot across the bow saying that I was a Leaf homer on this podcast. Fans of this pod will know that you're equally as such for the Pittsburgh Penguins. But I'm going to bet with my head instead of my heart, as I always do in these pods, AJ, and you may be surprised by the way I lay out my division standings, which we will do the Canadian division first, so the suspense will only last a week or so, but I'm pretty sure you've got the Penguins locked in at number one, no matter what the division is that they're in, so there's my return of serve. But before we get into the nuts and bolts of today's podcast, we got another bit of news, AJ, and that's a new sponsor. Please introduce that sponsor to our listening audience.
Absolutely. Well, we are happy to welcome BetMGM as a new sponsor of the podcast, a new RotoWire partner. Sports bettors know that magic happens when you turn a hunch into action and apply the right amount of expertise. That's why BetMGM has teamed up with RotoWire to offer new BetMGM customers a free six-month RotoWire subscription when they place their first bet. Register on the BetMGM app or website and use promo code ROTO, that's R-O-T-O, to claim your free subscription. Once you make your first sports wager, you'll receive a season's length of RotoWire's unmatched sports insight. Find out why BetMGM is the king of sportsbooks by signing up and placing your first bet today. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Colorado, Indiana, New Jersey, Nevada, Tennessee, and West Virginia only. Please gamble responsibly. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-522-4700 in Colorado and Nevada and 1-800-GAMBLER in New Jersey and West Virginia. In Tennessee, call or text the Red Line at 800-889-9789. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT in Indiana. Promotional offer not available in Nevada.
Thanks very much, buddy. Great job on that read. Okay, AJ, let's take a look at the biggest single, biggest signings and player movements by each club this offseason, beginning with the Anaheim Ducks. It looks to me like Kevin Shattenkirk has parlayed the last couple of seasons of bouncing around in a very nice contract for himself. He's got a multi-year deal signed up here and a cup ring to go with it. Played a significant role in the Lightning's cup run. I'm happy with for him that he's taken advantage of the situation and made this signing look like a real good deal for himself. I wonder if you think there are any other notable issues there in Anaheim, but it's one team that didn't do a lot in the offseason. They've got their cap in order, though, one of the few teams that is marginally over the cap. They'll have to do a little bit of tinkering, minor. So, but there are a couple of teams that we'll take a look at later on in this list where the teams are well over the cap, including the one that you're going to bring us up to date on, the Arizona Coyotes, sitting there about $2 million over the cap. But what did they do in the offseason notable to your eyes?
Yeah, so just, some quick thoughts on Anaheim. I think Kevin Shattenkirk is their big addition. Really, this is just a club that's kind of waiting to see if some of these younger guys can make that next step forward. You're talking about guys like Troy Terry, Sam Steele, Max Jones, even Sonny Milano. He's been around a little bit longer, but really it's kind of a wait and see. And they added a pretty big piece on defense. They've got the netminder and John Gibson. There's no concerns there. So it's just a matter of development. They've done the drafting, and now they have to see if these guys are going to develop. And that's really the big hiccup for them to see what they can do. You mentioned, yeah, we'll talk about Arizona next. Obviously, the departure of Taylor Hall is never a good thing for them. They did add what I would call relatively minor pieces in guys like Tyler Pitlick, John Hayden, Dryden Hunt, Johan Larson. But again, no big signings here. Perhaps their biggest acquisition was not trading away Oliver Ekman-Larsson. I know things haven't always been a fit there with him, but keeping him, I think, is better than not, in my opinion. And Paul, you mentioned it. They are the team most over the cap right now. Based on our friends at Cap Friendly, they're looking at $84 million in terms of the cap hit. So there's got to be a move somewhere, and they actually only have 22 guys under contract. Now, that could be one short-term fix for them, that they just carry 22 guys at the start of the year. The cap in hockey is actually calculated daily. It's a little bit of a complicated system there. They also have Marian Hossa, that they still have his contract, so the LTIR. So they actually might be okay. I would have to double check and see if they're using that, but I think that's going to be what gets them there. So they're actually probably okay, and might even be able to add that 23rd roster spot just by having that LTIR from Marian Hossa.
Well, you mentioned the captain, Oliver Ekman-Larsson. He's carrying an $8.25 million cap hit for the next several years, age 29 season coming up, and he's locked up for the next five seasons after this one. So his name's been in the news, though, AJ, along with the Boston Bruins. If they pivot away from Zdeno Chara, they may be a team that comes calling on Arizona to see if they'd be willing to trade their captain and maybe have him replace the retiring Boston captains if Chara decides to hang them up. From what I hear, we'll get to Boston in a minute. There's some news there in that circumstance as well that may impact his decision. But, AJ, I think that's one situation where Arizona may have to contemplate biting the bullet, because they are the team that's the highest above the cap, and so they got to look at perhaps a significant move. LTIR might help them, but if it doesn't, you can bet that taking a serious look at the big contract of their captain is an issue. And speaking of the Boston Bruins, they have a couple of other injury issues in the offseason that they're dealing with. David Pastrnak had offseason surgery. He won't be ready to start the season, but they acted proactively and they signed Craig Smith to a multi-year contract. He was a career right winger in Nashville for the past 9 seasons. He's been toiling there in relative anonymity. This guy is one of those plug-and-play guys, been a second-line type, but he's going to be thrust into first-line duty if Pastrnak is late to the start. That's why they're bringing him in, to be a heavy hitter in the top 6 in any case, but he might get the premium assignment on that big top line. Greg McCaig is another guy that came over to boost the bottom 6. Other than that, the Bruins really may be looking at tinkering around the edges, but a significant move might be necessary if Zdeno Chara decides to hang them up. He's just waiting to see how things unfold in terms of the scheduling and whether there's a hub city involved, and he wants to be really careful about diving back into the fray at 43 years of age. He doesn't need to do this anymore. It's pretty simple. He's got to be happy with the environment that he's headed toward in this shortened season, and he's going to take a long look at things, and it'll be interesting to see how this thing plays out. AJ, any hunches at your end on that issue?
Yeah, I think they're probably going to get him back, is my guess. I just feel like it maybe hasn't ended the way they wanted to. Look, if Boston were to have lifted the cup last year, the year before, or, even next year, I think then we'll see Big Z kind of walk off into the sunset. But, one more shot at it. Like you said, they've got Marchand and Bergeron still around, so their window is still open. So I would be a little surprised if he walked away. So I imagine they will have him back. The couple of teams we've talked about so far, not big movers or shakers so far this season in terms of offseason additions. That's not the case with the Buffalo Sabres. They went big. They got Taylor Hall in there, even the Tobias Reeder acquisition as well, and then Matt Irwin as a kind of depth defenseman. Look, it was interesting to listen. We kept hearing over and over, Taylor Hall's not going to take a one-year deal, not going to take a one-year deal. That was what was coming out of their camp because they wanted that long-term, and things just didn't work out with the flat cap and everything. He's certainly still getting paid 1 year, $8 million to go play in Buffalo. But I do think I would be surprised if he re-signs there. I think this is a one-year deal. He could get kind of the most money he could out of the Sabres. He'll play, put up big numbers again. Maybe playing with Eichel will do something for him, but I would be surprised if this is more than just a one-year, hey, look at how great I am, now somebody else give me a big contract.
Yeah, he's certainly put himself out there this way, but he's put himself out there in a really good situation. There's no doubt that he's going to partner with Eichel to form one of the more dynamic-looking duos in the league, at least on paper, to start the season. And that could be bad news for a couple other guys that have been in the top 6 there, particularly Jeff Skinner, and he's locked up for $9 million over the next several years, too. So that could be a bit of an albatross-type contract for this season anyway, if Taylor Hall does take Skinner's spot on that top line. So it remains to be seen. But other than that, they did tinker around the edges very, very, in a very small way, and locked in our two goalies that are nondescript at best in Hutton and Ullmark, and that might hurt this club in this shortened season. They're veteran goalies, but neither one of them inspires me too much, AJ, if I can be blunt. Carolina Hurricanes is a team that has had a couple of really good playoff runs recently, and they didn't do much in terms of name recognition types added to the roster this offseason. Jesper Fast might be the biggest name of all of them, and a guy who they hope will combine with several other European-born stars in their roster, in their top 6. Otherwise, it's Drew Shore and Joachim Ryan who are fitting in terms of depth roles on this roster. But they've got a lot of pieces in place, AJ, to be a serious contender, no matter which division they play in, I think.
Yeah, I really like the Jesper Fast acquisition. I mean, you look at this third line now, it's a little more stabilized than what they've had in the past. You've got Jordan Staal as your third line center, Jesper Fast as your right winger. Left wing could be a bit of a rotation. Ryan Zingel could be in the mix there, Warren Fogle as well. But to have kind of those two guys that I think will anchor their third line, I really like that acquisition for them. I don't think there was a lot that they needed to do. Calgary, on the other hand, had a lot of work to do, and they certainly did it basically by raiding Vancouver. They got Jacob Markstrom, Chris Tanev, Josh Levo, spent a cup of coffee there as well. So they really went big on a couple of guys. Then some other depth guys, Joachim Nordstrom, Dominic Simone, Nikita Nesterov is going to come back from overseas. And so a lot of real big additions at some major, you know, spots on this team. Obviously, Markstrom comes in to potentially be the number one over Rittich. Tanev figures to maybe be top pairing, second pairing. I actually like the idea of having him with Giordano on a top pair. I think it'll really free up Mark Giordano to jump up in the play. So, yeah, a lot of moves by them to really kind of help build around. You know, they've got the core that's been there a little bit longer with, you know, Gaudreau, Monahan. They've got the up-and-coming core kind of guys with Tkachuk and Dylan Dubé. And so I really think it's kind of coming all together for them. This will be a difficult team to play against with these new acquisitions.
Yeah, I love what they did in net with Markstrom. I think he was the best free agent goalie acquisition by any club in the NHL. Surprised, really, that Vancouver saw fit to let him go. And letting him go to a Canadian-based rival, that could come back to haunt them regularly this season. And I agree with your call on Chris Tanev. He's going to be a very nice fit replacing TJ Brody on that first D pairing with Giordano. One guy that you didn't mention too much is Dominic Simone, a guy that you're familiar with because of your fandom. But I think once he gets healthy, he's dealing with a bit of a shoulder, Nick, at this point, but he should be ready early on in the season. And he could threaten to support a top six role if any of their top six guys go down. Maybe he even replaces Andrew Mangiapane on the left side of the second line if he has a good start to his season. So that's a couple of situations we can look forward to early on. The Chicago Blackhawks, this is a team that kind of did their makeover on the fly. They had to change things up on their roster because of salary cap restrictions, but I think they've done a pretty nice job. And their work continued this offseason with the signings of Matthias Janmark, Nikita Zadorov, and Lucas Walmark. I really like the Zadorov signing. He adds a lot of bite to their back end, a big defenseman who can hit and is very mobile. So that's an area where they needed some work to be done, and I think he's going to benefit from a little extra ice time, more responsibility here. I think that's a guy to keep an eye on the back end in Chicago.
Well, I'm really surprised that they weren't a bigger player in the goalie market. I'm really, really shocked that they're going to enter the season with Malcolm Subban and Colin Delia as the two options there. But, you know, the season hasn't started. Maybe there's, you know, something in the works as far as a trade or something. But, yeah, I'm quite surprised that that's the tandem that they're going to go with. But, yeah, to your point, the other kind of, you know, depth pieces, maybe Zadorov's not really depth, but yeah, to kind of, you know, rejigger on the fly for lack of a better term. Columbus had kind of one big move in bringing in Max Domi there. They did also sign Mikko Koivu and really kind of changed up the look of their center position. You know, part of that comes from Brandon Dubinsky, for all intents and purposes, I think is done due to that wrist injury. We'll have to wait and see, you know, more details once camps open up, but I'd be shocked if he plays again. So now, you know, you're looking at PLD, Pierre-Luc Dubois as number one, Domi, Koivu as the two and three. And so I really like kind of how they've built from the middle. I think there's still some deficiencies with this team. We'll get into that in our previews, but two solid acquisitions in my opinion.
Yeah, and in terms of Pierre-Luc Dubois, he is unsigned. He was a restricted free agent, but they've got about $9 million to spend, and I'm sure he's going to come in under that. So no cap issues really for this team. They got one roster spot. He's going to fill it. So no concerns there. But I got enough of a look at this team in the playoffs last year as they ousted my club in the first round, and I really liked what I saw in terms of the makeup of the club. They're very well coached. As everybody knows, they've got a really nice tandem in the nets there with Merce Lincolns and Corpusello. So lots to be looking forward to for the Columbus fans. And speaking of lots to look forward to, Colorado, this team looks like it's loaded for bear. And they made a couple of really smart acquisitions, I think, in the offseason, too, with a deal that brought in Brendan Saad from the Blackhawks, and Devin Taves was a signing from the Islanders to bolster an already decent-looking defense. So I think Colorado is primed to be one of the top contenders in whatever division they play in going forward, because they have a lot of talent on this roster, and they just added some nice pieces with the moves that I outlined. AJ, what do you think about any of the moves and or the way this team looks at the moment?
Well, they certainly had to give up a lot to get Taze, a couple second round picks in future drafts, but I think he's totally going to be worth it. That might be one of the best trades of the offseason. I really like that acquisition for them. They've got a really dynamic group of defensemen here now. And that doesn't even include a guy like Bowen Byram, you know, who may or may not make the team this year, depending. I really love this D core. It might be the best defensive core in the league. I haven't really fully dove into to 100% back that statement, but I'll firmly say it's top three, if not number one. So I think that was a great acquisition. They signed him to a long-term deal after trading for him. So I think it'll be a good fit for Dallas. Pretty quiet offseason here, really. They did re-sign Anton Khudobin, so that's a good situation for them. But Mark Pisick, really the only acquisition that they really truly made, and I don't think they needed a lot of tweaks and changes here. They just kind of need everything to come together a little bit better, and I think. That's about it for them.
Well, I love the way this team looks on paper, AJ. They got a really nice offensive mix led by the likes of Sagan and Ben, but and Radulov, can't forget about him, really the heart and soul of their offense. But they've added a couple of pieces in recent years. Denis Gurianov is one guy that I really like that fits into their top six as well. Rupe Hintz, another guy, and they've locked these guys up for cheap contracts for the next couple of years. You need to get those contracts right on the young up-and-comers with bridge deals, and they did a nice job there. But this is another team that's predicated on defense first, and I like the depth that they have in this group. There's no fewer than eight guys that I would trust with regular minutes, Pisick being added to that mix, but don't be surprised if they use him in an offensive role. He thrived in Florida when he was moved up to the wing. So if this is a team that goes with four lines, this guy could see some time, maybe even in the same game at forward and defense, to provide a little bit of security in both ranks. But depth in goal is good, and solid looking depth forward on defense. In Detroit, this team had to be active in the offseason, AJ. They were at the bottom of the league pretty much in the standings, and lots of room for improvement. And they did spend some money in the offseason to bring in some name recognition types. In goal, a key acquisition, Thomas Greiss, should solidify things back there, but he better invest in a lot of tape and bandages, because he's going to be getting a lot of bruises and cuts for the pucks that he's going to face this season in the rubber factory that is the defensive end in Detroit. Bobby Ryan, feel-good story off the ice, getting his life together, but coming off a big cap hit, Ottawa had to part company with him, and Detroit got him for cheap, and he'll figure to be a top six player there. Troy Stetcher, a nice acquisition on the blue line, should factor into the top two defensive pairings there. Good mobility in him, and they further bolstered their back end with the additions of veteran Mark Stahl and John Merrill. Vlad Namestnikov is another forward who should contend for a top six role. So there's a lot of player movement into the fold in Detroit that should improve their lot this season, but there's still a lot of heavy lifting to be done, AJ, isn't there?
Yeah, absolutely. I will say, I think the Bobby Ryan deal may have been the best signing by any team this offseason. You're talking about a guy who went second overall in his draft class. Yes, there have been some off-ice issues, but, you know, really, you look at his production, and he's had pretty consistent numbers. I mean, yeah, he's not getting the 60-70 points he did when he was with Anaheim earlier in his career, but in a full regular season, I think he's still fully capable of being a 40-50-point guy. Now, this year, if it's a little shorter, maybe you're looking at 30 points, but I think you'd be super happy to get 30 points off a guy that you signed a one-year, $1 million contract for. I mean, I think it's a steal for them, and really a good move overall, for the Red Wings there. In terms of Edmonton, They also took advantage. Look, we've seen this happen a couple years in a row now. A guy gets bought out by his previous team, so he's not necessarily looking for a big-dollar contract. That was the case with Bobby Ryan, and in Edmonton, that's what happened with Kyle Turris, who signs a two-year, $3.3 million contract to go play in Edmonton. I mean, again, that's another one. If it doesn't really work out, you didn't have to break the bank. You're not committed to him really long-term. So I love that signing as well. He'll anchor probably their third line center position, and I think it'll be a really good fit for them. They also brought in Tyson Berry, Dominic Cahoon, Jesse Puljujarvi is going to come back from overseas, and so they, you know, they got another power play guy, I think, in Tyson Berry. Obviously, you saw a good amount of him last year. Dominic Cahoon is a player that I really like. I was bummed that the Penguins couldn't keep him around. And then, again, Puljujarvi, a relatively low risk. If it doesn't work out again, so be it. But I think it will. And so I really like – I know I sound like a broken record. Oh, I like this acquisition. But these were some of the better deals, I think, that were made this offseason.
You know what? Tyson Berry has a chance to rehabilitate his career after a downer in Toronto. AJ, I saw too much of this guy floundering around when he was surrounded by a lot of high-end talent. He just didn't make good on it. He was given the reins to a first-line role on a power play that featured some of the top shooters in the NHL when you think about the Leaf roster and the top six that they offer. And he didn't really take advantage of it. And I wonder if his fortune will be better surrounded by Draisaitl and McDavid and company there. So that remains to be seen. You mentioned about Cahoon. He could be a nice surprise, could fit anywhere in the top couple of lines if he gets a shot. He did get a couple of cups of coffee with Pittsburgh in those roles and did well from time to time. Torres is a guy that I have a lot of time for, dating back to his years as a world-class junior hockey player. He's way past that now, as he's into his early 30s, I think, and he's bounced around a little bit in terms of opportunities up and down different rosters, and this might be a last chance saloon for him with a shot to do well in a third line role in a talented roster like Edmonton. But Puljujarvi is a guy that I think I'm most intrigued by what to expect from him. He was, I believe, in the top three of his draft year, AJ, a couple of years ago, and really things didn't pan out. It was part of the run the Oilers had of winning the draft lottery almost every year. This was one that they didn't win, but still getting a top pick. And this guy just didn't pan out. He went back home and he had a couple of good seasons to kind of rehabilitate his outlook, and will be given a shot to prove that he still has something in the tank as a talent in that mix in Edmonton. But we'll see what the outlook is as the season unfolds there for him. In Florida, this is a team that did a lot of moves in the offseason. Veteran Radko Gudas bolsters the defense, gives him some bite back there. Vinny Hinostroza is a guy that could contend for a second-line center role. Patrick Hornquist is a guy that you know a little bit about from his time in Pittsburgh, an agitator who can be a role player on a power play here and maybe be the net front presence, so keep an eye on that circumstance for him. Alex Wenberg, Carter Verhaeghe, Ryan Lomborg, Marcus Nutivaara, these are all depth guys. Nutivaara will be a depth defenseman on this team, might get a shot at second pairing, but in all likelihood lower than that. Tinkering around the edges, but beefing up the toughness with Hornquist and Gudas is the key factor that I know with the Florida moves.
Yeah, absolutely. You look at a team that's going to play a lot tougher, a lot grittier, and be that, you know, that hard to beat team from that standpoint. So the Wenberg deal is a little bit concerning to me. You know, he is just 26 years of age. It's only a one-year deal, but his numbers have just steadily declined the last few seasons after kind of peaking back in 2016-17 with 59 points there. Has only topped the 10-goal mark once in his career, and this is the guy right now, by all accounts, is going to, you know, center your second line. So a little bit confounding there to me. I don't love the addition. If they brought him in to be a third-line center, maybe it makes more sense, but not as their second line center. So I think there's some concerning deals here, or maybe misses rather, that could have been contracts elsewhere. In terms of the LA Kings, their biggest acquisition this offseason was Olli Maatta. This is another one that confounds a little bit here. You know, the trade that they did. It was kind of more of a salary dump for the Blackhawks. I'm a little surprised LA didn't get more back for taking on the Mata contract here. He's just not, I mean, it just, he's slowed down to the point that it's hard to, you know, really trust him to pair up anywhere. And with their lineup right now, you might be putting him with Drew Doughty. Mata did have some decent seasons early in his career playing alongside Chris Letang, but that didn't work out a lot, and he's only gotten a little bit slower, and he's not the fastest skater, so I'm not sure that that'll really pan out for them long term. So if there's a deal that I didn't really like for this for a team, it's definitely this one. Now for them, we'll get into it more, but this is another wait and see team. You got to see how some of their younger guys develop, and so that's why they weren't really being active on the market, I think.
Well, you mentioned not being active. They, along with Florida, I forgot to mention that both teams have 4 roster spots open in terms of meeting the 23-man limit if they want to, in terms of pro contract signed. They're each sitting there with 19 players. The Kings have spent $67 million, so they got about $13 or $14 million to spend. There's some notable free agents still out there, so they may still take a swing at a couple of those names. If you look at the list, there's a couple of guys that are intriguing enough for me to think they might be interested in Mikael Granlund. They might be interested in a Sami Vatanen to bolster their defense if they want to. So there's a couple of, Mike Hoffman is another name that's out there. There's a couple of guys who could really help this team if they want to take a shot at spending some of that money. It remains to be seen whether they will or not. So that's the curious thing for me in an otherwise quiet off season for the Kings. In Minnesota, they were a little bit quieter than some teams, but they did do some damage, more than the last two that we covered, and that's adding in the Nets, Cam Talbot, who will get another chance to be a first-string goalie in this league. Marcus Johansson cashed in big to hopefully continue his career as a top-six forward. Nick Bonino is a guy that will challenge for a top-six role at center. Nick Bjugstad needs to rehab a couple of down seasons in the past couple of years in Pittsburgh that didn't really work out, and he gets a chance to find some work in Minnesota in a team that has some opportunities in their top-nine for sure, maybe even top-six.
Yeah, the thing with Bjugstad is really he's got to stay healthy. I mean, that's been the biggest problem with kind of trying to find a way to gel with Pittsburgh, is he just could not stay healthy. He could not stay in the lineup for a while. So that's obviously going to be, the deal for him. I like the Cam Talbot signing. If you get the Cam Talbot that played 73 games and racked up a whole bunch of wins, you're going to be real happy about that. If he struggles a little bit, then, you know, it'll give you an opportunity to, you know, do you want to go Alex Stalock for a couple of years, or is it time to go to Kaapo Kähkönen and kind of transition to the future? So I think it's a good signing to kind of bridge that gap of where they are in terms of an organization and their future between the pipes. Montreal, we talked about Max Domi went one way. Josh Anderson was the piece that comes back. They also have Tyler Toffoli. They brought in Joel Edmondson to kind of bolster that blue line. And then the one move that I was a little confounded about early on was Jake Allen, only because that's a lot of money to be spending on your two netminders here. I mean, when you've got a flat cap coming in and you're going to commit almost $15 million on your two netminders, I was a little surprised by that move. But if we're looking at a condensed schedule, playing multiple games in back-to-back night formats, it definitely makes sense to have two really, you know, Carey Price is the number one. I think it would be a disservice to call Jake Allen a 1B only because of how good Carey Price is. But in most teams, I would say Jake Allen's probably your 1B. In hindsight, I think it's a good deal. At the time, I was maybe not so sure about it. The one thing with the Josh Anderson acquisition is I feel like they're getting a little bit stacked up on the right wing. You know, you can move Tyler Toffoli over to the left wing, but you do have Yoel Armia, Arturi Lehkonen. You know, obviously, Brandon Gallagher is going to be your number one there. So I'm not really sure who's going to fit where and what their second versus their third line is going to look like. But overall, I like bringing in the player, especially if, you know, Max Domi just wanted out, to get Josh Anderson and not have to worry about Domi, and, you know, what he's thinking, I think makes sense.
Looking at the Canadiens roster, I got to take a shot here, AJ. You know, I'm chopping at the bit to do that. But Jonathan Drouin and Josh Anderson are the top two guys at forward in terms of the salary cap hits. Drouin, we know about his struggles in Montreal the last couple of years. Josh Anderson comes into the fold here after an injury-plagued season. Sure, he looked okay in the playoffs, but what he did in the regular season for them last year should be a bit of a concern for Montreal fans. One goal, 4 points. 26 games played. I'll leave that there. And then in terms of Jake Allen, in the Nets, the other consideration, AJ, is at the end of the year, the Seattle draft takes place, and the Canadiens have to expose a player. Jake Allen will be definitely one of those players that gets exposed, and it may turn Seattle's attention away from some of the depth that the Canadiens have acquired on defense particularly, and to a certain extent on offense. So that could be another consideration for why Montreal did go that route. In terms of signing an expensive backup goalie. In New Jersey, this is a team that had a lot of money to spend. They didn't spend a lot of it, but the key acquisition that they did was a trade with the Maple Leafs in acquiring Andreas Johnsson. He was not going to be a top six player in Toronto with the depth the Leafs have, but he certainly gets that role and then some in New Jersey. Could be a guy that they build some of that offense around going forward. Up front, Dmitry Kulikov bolsters a defense that needs some work to be done. Ryan Murray is a former first-round draft pick that will certainly also get a chance to play there as well. The surprising move for me was inking Corey Crawford to a signing here. When I thought that they were going to finally give Mackenzie Blackwood the reins in the Nets, it looks like now he's going to have to battle Crawford for playing time. It's a pretty nice 1-2 situation, and maybe Mackenzie Blackwood learns a little bit from the 2-time Stanley Cup champion.
Yeah, absolutely. And, well, let's not forget to what you just said, Paul, that the Seattle draft is right around the corner. Crawford's on a 2-year deal, so he could be potentially the guy that they expose there, although they do have Scott Wedgwood as well. I think it makes sense to me, I think, overall in terms of bringing in a guy, a veteran guy like that, that can maybe take the reins if you need him to, or can, transition over to Blackwood, you know, full-time moving forward. For the Nashville Predators, you've got mostly a couple of depth acquisitions, I would say. You got Mark Borowicki, Matt Benning, Nick Cousins, and Brad Richardson. Richardson maybe the one guy that, when, you know, fully fit, could push for a top six role. But I think, you know, your 1-2 center punch is pretty solidified in Ryan Johansson and Matt Duchene here. I do like them getting Luke Kunin as part of the Bonino deal. I think he'll have a chance to play a bigger role on this team. And of course, you know, they just had to tinker with the blue line a little bit. Their top four is pretty much solid with you know, Yossi, Ellis, Ekholm, and Dante Fabro. So they didn't need to do a lot, I don't think. Maybe there's been some rumblings that maybe they would be in for a guy like Jonathan Marchessault if he's going to get traded away by Vegas, or maybe even Mark Stone. So maybe they're in on one of those kind of cap dump moves.
And they do have some money to spend too, so we'll see if they get active in that regard, AJ. But I'm intrigued with the goalie situation. Pekka-Rinne, the longtime incumbent as the starter, was challenged for that role at times last year, with UC Saros taking a big step forward. And maybe he gets the lion's share of the goaltending mix going forward. But at best, it looks like a 50-50 split in there. And look, behind that stout defense, they're going to be well protected. I think this is a team, one of the teams, we talked about it last year, and I don't think things change. They could be one of the teams that actually protect four defensemen again going forward this season in terms of that expansion draft upcoming. In New York Islanders' circumstance, not too much in terms of free agent work. Dmytro Timoshov was just acquired recently in a trade where Lou Lamoriello knows something about this guy from his time in Toronto. And he was in Detroit last season after a trade with the Leafs, but gets a shot to reunite with his former GM that drafted him. And I think there's something there that tells me that Timoshov will get a long look with the Islanders to see if he can crack the top nine forwards, let's say. But there's a lot of excitement around the other guy that is going to make his debut on the island, and that's Ilya Sorokin, a highly regarded goalie prospect, one of the best outside of the NHL last season, and I'm curious to see how he fits in to the outlook going forward. They do have a little bit of money to spend as well, so maybe they're not done in terms of all the work that that needed to be done in the offseason. And AJ, that probably is more intriguing to me than anything that else that they did in the offseason.
Yeah, the Sorokin, I'll call it signing, convincing him to come over, I guess, would be the good way to phrase that. I think is going to be the most intriguing thing to watch with this team heading into the upcoming season and really training camp to see, are they going to do the split kind of thing they've done the last couple of years? Is either one of these guys, Varlamov or Sorokin, going to, kind of take over and really take the reins? I expect at most we'll see a 60-40 split with this team, but you never know if either one of these guys gets hot, it could skew one way or the other there. The other New York club here, the Rangers, look, their biggest acquisition was just by winning the draft lottery and getting Alexis Lafreniere in. I can't imagine this guy doesn't end up at minimum on the second line with Strome and Buchnevich, but he could push for the first spot with Zibanejad and Chris Kreider as well. Although, look, I would be really intrigued to see a line of him on the left, Kapokako on the right. That would offer some very intriguing matchup problems, I think, for a lot of other teams. In terms of the other moves that they made here, mostly kind of minor stuff. Jack Johnson, they signed him. He'll maybe be a third-pairing guy, but they also signed Anthony Beteto. So I figure they're probably both competing for one open spot. I'd be surprised if either one of them plays all, 56 games or whatever it's going to be that we have. And then some depth forwards in Kevin Rooney and Colin Blackwell. But really, again, their biggest acquisition came through the draft.
And let's talk about that for a second, AJ. There's been some talk in the offseason about the expansion draft and the lottery portion of it, that maybe they should do something to really help the lower teams. The Rangers weren't at the bottom of the standings. They won the lottery as a bit of a long shot, and they got the big prize the way it turned out. And in some quarters, there was a big upset about that outcome. And, I mean, it could have been the Penguins. It could have been the Leafs, too. That's the kind of teams that he was being offered the chance to play with just because of the lottery balls falling a certain way. The bottom eight teams missed out on this guy.
Yeah, I mean, I do think there's maybe some discussion worth having. The lottery system is supposed to prevent against, tanking for the sake of trying to get the first overall pick. And I'm not convinced that any team recently has really tried to do that to improve their odds. And it was a weird year with how they structured it, The biggest thing is, the Penguins, even though they lost in the play-in round of Montreal, let's be honest, the Penguins should never have had any sort of a chance at getting Alexis Lafreniere. It shouldn't have happened. I would have loved to have him on our team, but I could certainly understand outrage from other clubs if he has. And look, you got to look at a club like Detroit that's been bad for several years, and they keep getting bumped down and bumped down when it comes to the lottery picks. So that, they just have had no luck at all the last couple of years.
And even the Ottawa Senators, a team that we'll profile next, they could have been in line for a nice bump if they could have got Lafreniere into their mix. To their credit, though, they did spend a little bit of money. I was hoping they would do a little bit more, but I like the additions of Evgeny Dadonov up front, and Matt Murray in the Nets signed a big deal to be the sacrificial lamb in the Nets for this season. Can't imagine he's going to enjoy playing in this all-Canadian division with all the snipers on all the other teams that he'll be facing. Alex Galchenyuk gets a chance to rehab his flagging fortunes with a chance to reclaim a top six role here. Excited to see if he takes advantage of that circumstance. Eric Goodbranson should bolster the defense here. I like what they've done retooling the back end, AJ, and all of a sudden they've got some quality there with the likes of Goodbranson and Shabbat anchoring things, but there's still more work to be done on the blue line, and there's going to be a lot of competition for those jobs, and maybe Ottawa does continue to look around. They're one of the teams that have over $12 million in cap money available to see if they can further bolster that back end and see if they can kind of close ranks on any other club in the Canadian division.
I mean, I'll be shocked if they spend any more money. Their ownership has been pretty clear that they were going to be closer to the floor than to the ceiling. So, I'd be surprised that if they did that. The moves that they have made are mostly pretty good. I mean, I hope Tim Stützle comes in and he should be a top six option for them, I think, and really help with that. They've got Brady Tkachuk, so there's some up-and-comers here. And then to add a guy like Dadonov to be a top-six guy, Alex Galchenyuk can push for that. Austin Watson even, I think, could challenge for – he should be in the top nine, but I think he could challenge for top-six as well. So they've brought in a couple of guys here in Murray, Galchenyuk, and Watson who may be motivated to revitalize their careers a little bit. And maybe they're taking a flyer on those guys, but if it works out, then great, and you're looking pretty solid.
Taking a flyer
for
on
our
those
next
guys,
team,
I like
we'll
those.
Dive into the Flyers there. They brought in Erik Gustafsson, was kind of their big acquisition. They also brought in Derek Pouliot. Other than that, it's been pretty stand pat. You know, they haven't needed the net mining help. Their forward group has remained largely the same. So just a couple small acquisitions. Gustafsson, maybe not a small acquisition. He'll push for top 4 minutes, but they only paid, 1 year, $3 million for him. So really not spending a lot of money here.
Yeah, that's an intriguing name, though. A couple of years ago, he posted a 60-point season, AJ, but then he reverted back to career norms. So you wonder if he still has another breakout season in terms of point production on the back end, but he should fit in very nicely in a top four surrounded by Sanheim, Gostisbehere, and Provorov, at least on paper. And add in the likes of Braun and Hag. That's a pretty nice-looking top six on the back end, retooling the defense on the fly and bolstering a pretty solid-looking group of forwards there. So I like the outlook for the Flyers heading into this season. They did solve their goalie conundrum of many years with Carter Hart, too. So I don't think you should be too happy when the Penguins line up against them this year. But speaking of the Penguins, I look at the moves that they made this offseason, and a couple of them, are familiar names to me in terms of Cody Ceci and Kasperi Kapanen. Kapanen was not going to play a first-line role in Toronto anytime soon, but could be a very interesting pick if he gets to play in the top six. And he's, I hear, ticketed for top line possibility with Sidney Crosby. So we might have to figure out a side bet on that one, AJ, to see how that works out in terms of point production over under. Maybe we could do something like that. We have the annual dollar bet that's in store. And I'm on a bit of a losing streak. I've lost the last two. So I got to come up with a good one here to get back on the rails, AJ. Colton Sevier and Michael Matheson, another interesting pick that could fill out a key role in the back end. But I'm curious to hear what you have to say about Kasperi Kapanen and Cody Ceci. Where do you think they fit into your team's fortunes this season?
Well, Kapanen's going to get the first line spot. They said that kind of roughly, it kind of came out a little bit that's what they were doing it when they made the trade. And then in interviews since then, Mike Sullivan has said that Kapanen will be the first line right winger with Sidney Crosby and Jake Guentzel. He really fits the mold of the type of player that Sidney Crosby wants, a speedy winger who can create space for Crosby and everything. So I really think that's going to be a great fit for him. The couple of acquisitions, they got Evan Rodriguez back after they traded him away. Mark Jankowski comes in to maybe take over as the third line center, pushing Jared McCann to the wing. So a couple guys that they brought in, again, are more low risk acquisitions. You hope that they work out, but if they don't, you didn't pay up real significantly. I'll be honest, I hate the Mike Matheson trade. I didn't like it at any point. If you're gonna dump Hornquist, it should have been for a salary dump, not for a guy that has an equally bad contract. And I like the Cody Ceci signing even less. I think I would love to have seen them go with Chad Ruhwedel as the sixth defenseman. By all accounts, he was arguably their best defenseman for leading up to the shutdown. Prior to injuries, he was their best shutdown defender in February and in the early part of March. And so I'm not sure why they felt they needed to go out and get Cody Ceci. Pierre-Oliver Joseph is expected to push for a roster spot and could join the team at some point here. So it just felt like an unnecessary signing. So the choices on the blue line have been a little confounding to me at this point. Obviously, you know, dumping Jack Johnson improved the Penguins' defense just by subtraction, addition by subtraction there. But yeah, I think Ruedel should have been given the opportunity there, and I don't think they needed to sign Cody Ceci. But I loved the acquisition of Kapanen. I know we had to maybe give up something for a guy that we previously had to give up to get Phil Kessel. So I love having him back. So some good moves, some bad moves, I think, for the Penguins. In San Jose, they added a very familiar piece in Patrick Marleau. He comes back to San Jose after being traded to Pittsburgh last year for a shot at the Cup. Look, I think this team, I don't know. I'll be honest. I don't know really what happened here for this team last season. The goaltending was a question mark, but that wasn't the only problem that they had. So I think they're right there to be actual contenders. They addressed the goaltending by signing Devin Dubnyk and bringing him in, or rather a trading for Devin Dubnyk. They didn't really have to give up much to do that either, and it was future picks in 2022. So from that standpoint, if you're potentially trying to win now, who cares about those future picks? Ryan Donato comes in, Matt Nieto as well. A couple veterans here and addressing some concerns, and I think a good piece of business for the Sharks.
I'm going to disagree. I think they made a bit of a mistake in terms of the net minding. They got 230-somethings in the back end there, and really maybe this is a shot across the bow for Martin Jones to get him to wake up and say, you know what, we gave you the reins for the last several years, and his fortunes have gone south in the last two seasons for sure, and maybe that's why they bring in Devin Dubnyk. But really, there's a lot more work to be done to call this team a contending club. Patrick Marleau, too, the acquisition for him, it signals a shot at for a player to break one of the NHL's most hallowed records, and that's total games played by one Gordie Howe. And that's probably the last record that Gordie Howe has of real significance. And you're talking about Mr. Hockey here. And should Marleau play out the whole campaign, one of the longest standing records, one of the ones that I thought would never be broken, will be broken by a guy who's had a couple of cups of coffee, both in Toronto and Pittsburgh. So interesting to see how that plays out, AJ, going forward. St. Louis, this is a team that's a year removed from winning the Stanley Cup. So you figured they still have some key players on this roster to take a run at things. They certainly lost their captain in the offseason, and Alex Pietrangelo, will get to his situation shortly, but they turned around quickly and acted proactively, rather, to get Torrey Krug signed up, picking him up off the Boston free agent heap and signing him to a big-dollar deal. There, Kyle Clifford goes over to add some bite from the Maple Leafs. He didn't fit in here despite his desire to remain a Toronto Maple Leaf. They couldn't fit him in under the cap. Steve Santini and John Gillies round things out. John Gillies, long considered a top goalie prospect, might be a guy that eventually challenges for a position there as a backup to Binnington, but right now he's third in the pecking order. But curious to see how Krug fits in here. He was a real linchpin in Boston's power play and gets a chance to do the same thing in St. Louis, but his issue for me is trying to stay healthy, AJ, and be really worth the contract that he signed.
Yeah, absolutely. Injuries are always going to be the big concern here. But I think it was a great call by them when it became clear that Pietrangelo just wasn't going to be an option, to go out, get Torrey Krug, get him locked up, and set yourself up there to really not lose a ton. I do think Pietrangelo is the better of the two players. If all things being equal, I think I'd rather have him. But when you have to factor in the cap situation too, I think the amount of maybe lost production versus the less pay that you're giving Krug versus Pietrangelo, I think, is a net gain for St. Louis overall. We get to the defending Stanley Cup champions here. And, you know, Tampa had a couple minor deals with Andreas Borgman and Chris Gibson brought into the fold. But really the thing with them is who is going to be the guy that leaves. They waived Tyler Johnson. He was a free pickup, but his contract is such that nobody even wanted Tyler Johnson for free. He cleared waivers, went unclaimed. At this point, they might have to consider burying that contract in the minors. That gives them a little bit of space, but not a lot. So I think they're still going to be looking for a trade partner. Johnson's name has come up. Alex Killorn, I think, is a name that's come up as well. So they got to do something here. I think they're going to be hard pressed to keep the core really to, you know, maybe not the core. Their core is Stamkos, Kucherov, Palat, and Hedman on the blue line. But they lost Shattenkirk. So I think they're going to be hard pressed to repeat, given the cap situation.
Yeah, and don't forget Stephen Stamkos was injured in the playoff run, didn't play much of a factor there, and he's still listed as being out to start this season. So with their captain on iffy terms, and they're going to lose another key asset somewhere on this roster to get cap compliant. Teams are waiting for the Bolts to realize that it's going to cost them their first round draft pick, I think, is what I'm hearing too, AJ. So they're way over the cap, and the teams know that they have this club over a barrel, and somebody's going to step up eventually when they say realize they're going to have to give up that top pick and maybe another prospect to get rid of the contract that is causing the issue, to get under the cap limit that they face. In terms of the next club, that's the Maple Leafs. They were one of the more active clubs in the offseason, maybe the most active among teams that you might consider contending clubs as we look ahead to this season. Some of the names that they added are familiar ones: Joe Thornton, Jimmy Vesey, Wayne Simmons, Zach Bogosian, but then they also, and TJ Brody, but then they added Travis Boyd for some bite, and Mikko Leittinen, an interesting prospect from the KHL. He was the defenseman of the year in the KHL last year, AJ. So he factors into the Maple Leaf situation, and along with Brody, should solidify the top four on the blue line and maybe make it the most improved aspect of this team. But I'm really curious to see where VC, Simmons, and Thornton fit in. Thornton more for his leadership, but VC and Simmons are going to add some size to the forward ranks, and Simmons particularly some real physicality.
Well, we talked about this the other day, Paul, about how if you had Thornton and Spezza maybe 10 years ago, 10 years younger, what a center group this would be to have Matthews, Tavares, Thornton, and Spezza. But I do think both guys still have plenty left in the tank. Spezza and Travis Boyd will probably flip some minutes here. I would expect Jumbo Joe to be a full-time third-line center. And that, I think, will be good for guys like Kerfoot and VC to play with a player of his caliber and his experience. But for me, the best signing of all the ones you went through was definitely TJ Brody. I think he'll be a great acquisition. I expect him to see some time on the power play, maybe with the second unit, maybe with the first unit. But really, some good acquisitions there. And you mentioned Lehtinen, a very intriguing option to see how he can, you know, bring his talents over to the NHL level. So we'll dive into Vancouver. They brought in a Nate Schmidt on the blue line to kind of step into a little more experience. They do have a bit of a young blue line. And then they brought in some netminder that'll be, maybe a factor here. Obviously, I'm kidding here. Braden Holtby comes in. I think by all accounts, I would imagine he'll be given the shot to be the number one guy there, although Thatcher Demko is the heir apparent for them. So we'll kind of see what they do in terms of a division of labor there. But I like the addition of Holtby. We talked about Markstrom and being, I think we were both a little surprised Vancouver didn't make a stronger run at him. But if you really think that Demko is going to be the guy for the future, then to get Braden Holtby on a 2-year deal, you can expose him to Seattle if that's the way you want to go, is really an intriguing option. And look, there are going to be a ton of netminders playing in new places. We've got at least one more to talk about, but guys that are going to look really weird wearing a different sweater. Braden Holtby is one of those. Corey Crawford, we talked about, is another. And we'll talk about King Henrik in just a minute.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious to see how this works out. I mean, I said earlier on that losing Jacob Markstrom was going to be a tough blow for Vancouver, but they did the next best thing that they could in acquiring Holtby. I think he's got to look at his situation and say, I had a down year in Washington that probably cost me the chance to stay there. And he took a bit of a hit in terms of the salary cap that he could have got, and signing for a relatively modest $4.3 million over the next two seasons. So he has a chance here behind a very strong Vancouver team to rehab that career and get an uptick toward looking at his next deal, which should come after the 21-22 season. But Vancouver, a deep team all around, should be a contender in for the crown in the All-Canadian division with the addition. I like Nate Schmidt's addition, solidifying the top four on the blue line as well. Vegas, this is another team like Tampa, AJ, that really has a bit of an issue in terms of cap compliance. They sit right now over the cap by about $1.5 million, or a little bit less than that, but they still have to make a move to get under that cap. And some of the names that you're hearing being bandied about imply that they are looking to make more than one move going forward. I mean, you hear Max Pacioretty's name being thrown out, but then it looks like they've pulled that off the table and are looking at other ways to remain cap compliant. But the big reason why they have the cap issue is they went big in terms of signing the big fish in the offseason. That's Alex Pietrangelo joining the fold here, and a contending team, no question, but they're right now in cap hell. And I wonder if you see a way out for them, AJ.
Well, I mean, the part of the problem, I talked about this with Montreal, they've got $12 million committed to their two netminders in Marc-Andre Fleury and Robin Leonard. And they're, you know, Fleury's name has been bandied about as a potential trade spot there. They don't have the benefit of exposing anybody to the draft, so they can't save any cap space from that standpoint, because they're not required to expose any players. And so it'll be really interesting to see what shakes up. Look, a couple of the pieces, Thomas Nosek's name came up as someone that a lot of teams are targeting as far as being included on a trade that would have them take on cap. I should also note they have a pair of second round picks because they have New Jersey's second round pick next year. And so they have theirs and New Jersey's, so that's a position of strength for them. They could potentially trade one of those picks away. Honestly, with how good this team is and the fact that New Jersey's struggling, if I were them, I'd try and trade their own pick and keep New Jersey's. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see. But yeah, they're pretty much everybody's name has come up at one point or another on this team, with the exception of Pietrangelo as a guy that might be traded in order to get them under the cap here. So it'll be interesting to watch. Next, we'll dive into the Washington Capitals. And again, the new goalies and new places being the theme. Henrik Lundqvist will join the Capitals after his, I want to say off the top of my head, 15 years with the Rangers. So it'll be interesting to see him there, and especially considering you expect him to take on a number two responsibility. Ilya Samsonov, rather, is expected to be kind of the guy and you know, really take over the reins, with Lundqvist potentially being a 1B or a number two. So it'll be interesting to watch, again, how the goalie workload shakes out. They added Justin Schultz on the defense, as well as Trevor Van Riemsdyk. Van Riemsdyk more of a depth option. Schultz could be the number two power play guy. John Carlson obviously isn't going anywhere from that number one group. And then also Paul Ledoux. So really a bunch of defensive guys that they added and a netminder as well. Not a lot of changes to the forward group here. Pretty much the same guys that they've had for the last couple of years.
Yeah, they've really pointed at the defense, a point of upgrading the defense to bring this team closer to being a really high-end frontline contending club. They're always a contending club, but really this closes the gap on some of the other teams, I think, because we know they're loaded for bear offensively up front with the likes of Ovechkin, Backstrom, Kuznetsov, and Oshie and company. So they didn't really have much work to do there, but I really like what they did, bringing in a veteran like Schultz and signing Brendan Dillon late last season to a multi-year deal. Michael Kempney's an underrated guy. Van Riemsdyk, a serviceable third-pairing guy. So really like the moves on the back end in the last couple of seasons there. It'd be interesting to see what the King has left in the tank and the Nets. But Samsonov will get a chance to ply his trade and point himself toward a real big payday at the end of this season, which is the last of his entry year circumstance. So he gets a chance to be the lion in the tandem in the Nets there. So I'll be curious to see the goalie split that we might forecast once the serious shooting starts in a couple of weeks, AJ. We round out our look at the 31 teams with Winnipeg Jets, and they brought back Paul Stastny into the fold. He's familiar with the Winnipeg area, having been born there earlier in his life, obviously. But So he is surrounded by the likes of Derek Forbort, Nate Thompson, Dominic Toninato, less name recognition types, but Stastny's a guy from Western Canada who should fit in very nicely in the Winnipeg Mets and rounds out the offense, filling in that key second line role that has been a bit of a question mark for the Jets for the last few seasons. Really, things didn't work out for this guy to the length. My expectation in Vegas, I thought he was going to be a lock to be the number one center, but he didn't hold on to that job when surrounded by really good talent there. But I think he slots in better as a number two guy and should thrive back in Winnipeg this season. I look for big things from Paul Stastny this season.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the biggest thing that Paul Stastny gives them is the ability not to have to move Blake Wheeler to the second line center. They can put him back on the top line with Mark Scheifele and Kyle Connor and really kind of shores that up for the first time since Brian Little got hurt way back when. And so they haven't really had a good solution for the second line center. So I think it's a great move, a great acquisition by them.
AJ, that rounds out our look at the 31 teams. In the coming weeks, we're going to learn more about the makeup of the U.S.-based division, so we'll begin our divisional previews next week with a look at the 7-team Canadian loop, and you mentioned it's one that's loaded in the first 6 slots. I think we can both pencil in, maybe pen in, the Ottawa Senators to finish last, but I still think the Senators are going to surprise some of the other clubs in north of the border from time to time. Have you got any final thoughts before we sign off on the maiden voyage of the 2020-21 season?
Yeah, just, you know, excited to be close to having hockey back, especially because we've been in this kind of weird, pause period. There haven't been really signings, trades. Like, it was very busy right when free agency started, and it really has dried up the last several weeks. There hasn't been a whole lot of news just in general coming out of the league. So excited that we're getting close. Obviously bummed that we have to have, you know, a shortened season here. Looks like 56 games, but hey, shortened hockey is better than no hockey. So I will definitely take that. And then hopefully, you know, by having the abridged season this year, we can go back to being a full 82 game in the following campaign. And hey, we'll have 32 teams at that point, which that's great too.
Yeah, it's all good. But one thing that I'm going to miss out on is the live experience. I love going to the games, as you know, and I won't be able to, at least for the first half of the season, it looks like. But maybe things open up toward the latter part. It remains to be seen. But in any case, we're looking forward to hockey happening soon. And even if there's no fans in the stands, I find it great enjoyment to see the games being played on the ice. And we look forward to that starting in a couple of weeks' time. In the interim, you can look forward to our divisional previews as usual in the next couple of weeks, with the Canadian division being first up next Tuesday. And that wraps up this episode of Puckcast with Statsman and AJ, RotoWire's signature fantasy hockey podcast. I'm grateful for the faith that RotoWire has put in us, AJ, for 5 straight years to get on this gig. Look forward to it every Tuesday with you, pal. In the meantime, to our listeners, please remember to send your comments or questions on Twitter. Follow me, Paul Bruno, at Statsman22. You can follow AJ at AJSchultz24. As always, we invite you to listen into Puckcast to get our tips to stay out of the competition in your fantasy hockey planning and research. So long, everybody.